Introduction. So this is, I think, a case management a session. So we will go through the common cancers which we see and what should we be screening for, and should we be screening for them at a community level or at a individual level. So this, we all know these criteria from our community health textbook of Park and Park. So when you want to screen for a disease, the disease should be an important health problem. You should select a population, or the disease should have a high incidence in your population. And if you screen and you detect it, there should be a treatment, and you should have facilities where you are for diagnosis and treatment. There also should be a, what is called like a latent stage of disease, or a pre-malignant state in this setting. And there should be a test or a test to detect that. And this test should also be acceptable. We just talked about the 72 hours stool fat, and it's acceptable and not being acceptable aspects. Then, of course, it is important to understand the natural history of the disease. And it is important to have policies in place on who you should be treating and who you should not be, and should you treat or should you not treat. And obviously, it has to be cost effective. We are definitely a low middle income country, and in our setting, it has to be cost effective. And screening is not just a cross-sectional one-time thing. It is a continuous process, and that also should be kept in mind. And why do you screen? You want to screen for cancer because you want to detect cancer early, and you hope that by detecting cancer early, you reduce its mortality. And you also sort of hope that because you detect it early, you will give better treatment because it's in an earlier stage and the chance of cure is better. Now, the first thing is, what are the cancers which warrant screening? So as far as these go, this is data which is from all over the world. So the commonest in women is breast, lung, colorectal, and the cervix. In male, it is prostate, lung, and colon and rectum. Now, when you look at cancer-related mortality, what cancers are lethal? What do people die of? Lung is on top on both sides, colon and rectum in males and breast in women. Now, moving on to India, this is actually the GloboCan data from 2018 in India. So when you look at males, the majority of newly detected cancers in men is still actually head and neck. It is lip and oral cavity, followed by lung, gastric, colorectal. In women, breast is on top, followed by still cervix, ovary, and then you have head and neck and colorectal. So we will deal with screening for breast, cervix, a little bit of lung, and also a little bit of head and neck and colorectal. So I'd like you to take you through patients, and then sort of let's decide on what we will do for them. So this is a 45-year-old lady who's premenopausal, who's educated, she's a banker, she has a significant family history of this thing called a triple negative breast cancer. Triple negative breast cancer is ER, PR, and HER2-neo negative. It is the most aggressive variant of breast cancer. Her aunt and sister have had breast cancer. She went on a marathon to, you know, when she was with her sister, for her sister, and she wished to know if she is at risk for breast cancer and should she be having screening at the age of 45. The second patient is actually a 60-year-old lady who's retired. There's no family history, no comorbidities. She went to the US to visit her son, and she just heard that routine screening mammograms are mandatory for her age, and she also wanted to know what to do. Now, in the US, incidence of breast cancer starts actually in the 40, it goes up as people reach their 40 to 50, and the lifetime risk is around 12%. In the UK, it's around 1 in 8 or 1 in 10, so 10%. Strategies to screen for breast cancer are mammogram, clinical breast examination, and a self-breast examination. So mammogram is probably what has been studied from a long time ago, from as early as the 1970s to 80s. And whatever data we have has mostly come from the West, and it is from that era. Now remember, at that era, we did not know about molecular subtypes of breast cancer. We didn't know what was aggressive, what was not aggressive, what was indolent, and what was fast growing. The testing modalities, the accuracy of mammograms were also low. So this is actually something which was published in 2016, which actually showed us that, so this is the 1975 to 1990 is actually the time period where there was no routine mammogram. Excuse me. And subsequently, when routine mammograms were included, there was a increase in the incidence of invasive breast cancer. Metastatic breast cancer, the incidence has actually remained the same. Now, when you look at the tumor size and also incidence in and size-specific incidence in patients who are more than 40 years, So the red is actually tumors which are bigger, which are more than 2 centimeters, and the blue stuff is all which is smaller. So if you look at any point in time, the proportion of patients who have a larger tumor has probably decreased. But it is decreased mainly because we are detecting many more smaller tumors rather than numerically detecting less of larger tumors. Now again, I'll go over something called overdiagnosis. Now overdiagnosis is mainly that with the use of screening, we detect tumors which were otherwise indolent, which would have never been diagnosed, and the patient would have actually died with the tumor without even realizing that he or she had a cancer. Now these contribute significantly to most studies where most people quote mammograms and how mammograms have sort of tended to decrease breast cancer related mortality and so on. So if you look at early breast cancer and late breast cancer, so most cancer which is diagnosed early is actually which is diagnosed by a mammogram is actually carcinoma in situ, or which is localized disease. So when we talk about incidence, we talk about the number of cases in 100,000 women. So the absolute change in the diagnosis of these tumors has actually gone up, whereas in the larger size tumors it is almost the same. Now this has a lot of implication because in the West, where all screen detected people will be treated equally, irrespective of whether they are screen detected or not. And so there is a significant higher incidence of mastectomies then followed by radiation, because if you have breast conservation, you go on to radiation and a lot of other implications with their treatment. So this Cochrane review in 2013 actually assumed that from what they inferred was that for every 2,000 women who were screened for 10 years with a mammogram, one breast cancer related death could be avoided, and 10 healthy, asymptomatic, well people who would have never even thought of that they would have breast cancer would be treated with either surgery or radiation and so on. So the pitfalls of screening in breast cancer are one, overdiagnosis, and then of course you have your false negative patients. Now what is false negative is that there are HER2 positive tumors, triple negative tumors, which grow fast in the interval of 1 to 2 years between the mammogram. And false positive, if you have mammograms for 10 years consecutively, you are at 60% likely to sort of get a false positive report on a mammogram. And that will be followed with biopsy, anxiety, and so on. So moving on to the next modality, which is more of relevance to us, is what is called a clinical breast examination. This is simple, easy to perform, can be done by non-doctors as well. And this is only palpable tumors. So there is a very, very low false positive rate, and there is hardly any overdiagnosis. So there are trials which are actually ongoing in Bombay and in Trivandrum, in those tumor registry areas, which are looking at clinical breast examination and screening for breast cancer rather than mammograms. So these trials are yet to sort of, their data is yet to mature. But the earlier trials have showed is that if you detect a clinically palpable breast cancer, and if you detect a mammographically detected breast cancer, the benefit in survival is actually mostly related to the fact that you've detected a palpable breast cancer. So the goal of screening is actually not only to prevent death, it is not only to just detect the cancer, it is to prevent death. And mammograph doesn't really impact mortality. Now, how do you translate this to our practice? Okay, so self-breast examination has been talked about. There is no reduction in mortality, it only leads to a higher biopsy rate. So in the West, they have different ways of risk stratifying. So in a person who's at average risk for breast cancer, the screening starts early because they have a very good lobby component there. So people start getting screened by the age of 40 with a mammogram. Now you have patients who are at high risk for breast cancer. These are people who have, say, some genetic problem, or they have a significant family history, who've, say, had Hodgkin's lymphoma and had mediastinal RT at a younger age, or who have a genetic history. Now these are people where definitely this is a high-risk population, and these people should be screened. So when you go back to our patients, you have a lady with a significant family history who's educated. You should actually discuss the pros and cons of screening with a mammogram with her, considering the fact that she has a has a significant family history, and you could actually offer her a screening mammogram. The second patient, again is 60 and her expected lifespan is at least more than 10 to 15 years, this patient also can take an informed decision. Now this is based on a patient-to-patient basis. This is not on a community basis that the screening is recommended. Now the third patient is a 55-year-old lady who's a daily wage laborer from around two hours from Vellore. And if you see her in your OPD on Monday morning, she just comes with some vague menopause-related symptoms. Would you just order a routine mammogram for her, or would you examine her, do a clinical breast examination, educate her about a self-breast examination, or just not address her breast cancer at all? For this lady, in terms of, I would probably just include a clinical breast examination and educate her about a self-breast examination. This is, so in the population, in the community, the mammogram still probably doesn't have a place as far as we are concerned in India. The other disease is cervical cancer. This is again a 40-year-old lady who comes to our OPD with a URI. And apart from other things, she also tells us about how she has white discharge and dyspareunia. So this is a lady who's symptomatic, who should definitely at least have a pap smear and an examination by a gynecologist. The second patient is a 45-year-old lady whose mother died of cervical cancer at a young age. And she comes to your OPD with her 10-year-old daughter. She's asymptomatic. But she read about cervical cancer vaccines in the newspaper, and she wishes to take the vaccine and also include her, and she also wishes to vaccinate her daughter. So despite the data from the West, why do you still screen in India for CA cervix? Mainly because we have still a big population which is rural. In most of our cancer registries, which are metropolitan, say Mumbai, Delhi, Chennai, Trivandrum, the incidence of cervical cancer is less and the incidence of breast cancer is increasing. Whereas there are rural cancer registries where cervical cancer, the incidence is still almost remain the same. Now, cancer screening for cervix routinely is a pap smear, which may not be accessible to everybody at the primary healthcare level. So there was a trial from the Tata Memorial Hospital, which looked at something called visual inspection with acetic acid. And this was not done by doctors. This was actually done by social workers in a slum community in and around Mumbai. Now, moving on to the vaccine, the vaccine is actually listed in India as optional. And both the vaccines are effective. And the IAP actually recommends girls who are 11 or 12 years old to get two shots of either brand. Older girls, they recommend three doses. Now, recently we had a gyne-oncology conference here in Bagayam last week. So there was a debate there. Should the government invest in screening for cervical cancer, or should the government invest in vaccination? There's actually both are required, because both should happen together. Vaccination is actually for the daughters, and of course cost is preventing it from being mandatory. But if we did it in larger numbers, maybe it would be cost effective. And the screening is for the mothers. And remember, despite being vaccinated, those patients also will end up having to be being screened. Now, we don't know if the frequency should be different. There is no evidence to state that otherwise. So yeah, these were the two patients. Now moving on to head and neck cancer, because it's so common, I'm not sure how clear that is. So this is actually the flowchart which is given by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So what they have actually said is that for head and neck cancer, the most important thing is to screen people who have risk factors and sort of control the risk factors. And after that, at the primary health level, screening is done by the social worker and the nurse and so on. Okay, sorry, I think it's stuck. Oh yeah, okay, then moving on to lung cancer. So this is a 65-year-old male who still smokes 20 cigarettes a day for 40 years. He's a retired banker. He's very active. He volunteers at a children's home. So he went for a master health checkup, and he was handed a pamphlet on low-dose CT for screening for lung cancer. Okay. The second patient is a 37-year-old lady who was a never smoker. She just went for a pre-employment chest x-ray, found to have an opacity in the lung. And she was ultimately diagnosed to have lung cancer, had surgery and had chemo. But she, on retrospect, wants to know, should I have actually been screened? I'm only 37. Why did I get lung cancer? I'm not a smoker. So why screen lung cancer? Because worldwide, we know it's the most frequent cause of death. And the survival at 5 years is actually less than 20%. And again, the outcome is related to the size and stage. So smaller, earlier tumors do better, and obviously the more advanced one do worse. Now, how to screen? Earlier, there was sputum cytology. Then came along X-ray, then conventional CT, and of course low-dose CT. So the focus, I'll probably tell you more about low-dose CT. So chest X-ray and sputum cytology doesn't really help, and so this is not a standard of care. Now, earlier people were screening with CT chest, and these also didn't really help in terms of diagnosing earlier cancer. So there was one trial called the NLST, which was done in the US, and this looked at low-dose CT. Now, they were very smart. They selected a population of patients who were at high risk. So this was a randomized trial which looked at low-dose CT versus a chest X-ray. And these were patients who were either smoking currently or who had reformed and who had, you know, at least a history of 30 pack years. And this was around 50,000 odd patients. So here, these patients had CT, low-dose CT at T0, T1 and T2. That is at 1 year intervals. And what they actually found is that around 27% of these patients at T0 itself had a positive result based on their imaging, and then versus around 9% in the chest X-ray arm. So which actually very clearly states that chest X-ray is not, even in this high-risk population, chest X-ray is not that useful in picking up early tumors. So their relative reduction in the rate of death with low-dose CT was around 20%, and all-cause mortality was around 6% lower. Now, the problem with low-dose CTs, always there is overdiagnosis. That is something which you cannot overcome. And you have a risk of radiation-induced cancers in these patients. And I've sort of put the doses associated with each of these scans so that we get an idea. So for the first patient, again, on a case-to-case basis, in discussion with the patient, you can offer screening. But remember, there are a lot of other questions here. This trial included patients who are 55 to 74 years old and did 3 scans. Now, does the risk of lung cancer stop at, say, 58 or 59 years old? So when to stop screening, all those questions are there. So in our routine practice, we don't usually recommend a low-dose CT as a screening for a lung cancer, even in these high-risk population. For this lady, it is quite clear that this is not a standard of care and thing. Just one last thing on colorectal cancer, because I think a lot of medicine patients come with anemia and then get evaluated, found to have colorectal cancer. So again, here this is the American guideline. This is on risk stratification, actually. Everything is based on risk stratification. So what I'd like to highlight here is somebody who's average risk. In the West, people start screening with either a colonoscopy every 10 years or an annual stool occult blood and so on. I'm not sure how much of it is applicable to our clinical practice. So here you have a 56-year-old male with no comorbidities, no family history, just wants to know about screening for colorectal cancer. If he has all the money in the world, well, sir is here, so he could have a colonoscopy, he could have a stool occult blood every year. The second patient is somebody who's at high risk for colorectal cancer. This is a 37-year-old male whose brother had a CA colon at 40 years, and he is very anxious about his risk, and he wishes to know if he should have a colonoscopy right away. The answer here is that actually in somebody who has a family history of colon cancer, if the index case was less than 60 years, the family should be screened at least 10 years before the age of onset in the index case. So the second person probably warrants a screening colonoscopy and so what is the Indian government doing? So the Indian government has screening for 3 cancer types in place. So obviously the breast cancer, the age at which they start a CB is actually around 30 years. This is because when we look at data, the incidence of breast cancer is much earlier in India. So in the West, it starts at 40. What we have seen is that it is earlier. And patients have a clinical breast examination once in every 5 years. Cervical, same thing, VIA once in every 5 years, and then subsequently get referred if there's a problem. And oral cancer also, an oral examination every 5 years. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thanks, Anjana. That was you quite managed to cover quite a lot in that presentation. Thank you so much for it. And that's an approach that we could all benefit from. I'll just open the floor for any questions or any comments, any doubts, queries.
Clearly, my question is related to colorectal cancer. Is there any mathematical modeling that we can do to say, okay, at this point, the country needs annual FIT for their population, based on incidence? Or, I mean, in the sense, this now we do stool occult blood, but if we start this fecal immunochemical test, which is more specific for screening for colonic lesions, if the stool occult blood actually screens for any kind of blood loss.
The immunohistochemistry is...
Yeah, so if we set up that test, and you know, like the staff clinic will send you an email saying you're due for your annual checkup, and should we include this? Or is there some kind of number? Is this, okay, if the incidence is above this, that's the time to start for this population.
I think the way people have risk stratified is based on the incidence so far. And you look at that global, can you have everything else, cervix, breast and everything, head and neck sitting there. So that probably takes precedence more than colorectal cancer. So I don't know. That's as far as...